Greetings and welcome to Stem Cell Research and Cloning 101, a primer. This presentation is going to be exactly what that title suggests. This is a 101 level course. This is a primer, a basic book of instruction. This presentation is not going to be difficult, confusing, or complicated. And there are two reasons for that. One is that I'm not a scientist. I'm not an expert in these issues. Therefore, I couldn't make it complicated if I wanted to. Secondly, it doesn't have to be complicated. Once we understand the basic biology involved in these technologies, then we can apply God's word to them and make good God-pleasing decisions about them. So that's where we want to begin, with God's word. I'd like to lay two foundation stones for you upon which we can stand as Christians when we have to face these issues. It is important for us to understand what it is that gives value to human life, particularly what God has done that gives value to human life. First of all, human life has value because God creates life. In the very beginning of Genesis, we read that God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness." That's only said of those first two human beings, not of any of the other creatures that God made. Only Adam and Eve were made in His image and likeness. And as we get to Genesis 2, we see the care that God took in creating those first two human beings in His image. In verse 7, we read that God formed Adam from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. That combination of forming and breathing into is not used of any of the other creatures that God made. And the word formed is the same word used in the Bible of potters who are forming pots of clay and vessels. I don't know if you've ever seen that done, but it's always amazing to me that slimy lump of clay is put on that turnstile, and as it goes around, it looks like the vase or the vessel is coming right out of the potter's hands. And that's the picture that is created here. God was intimately involved with His hands in the creation of that first human being, giving that first human being value. And then we know that God put Adam into this deep sleep and took one of his ribs. And in Genesis 2:22, we read that the Lord God made a woman from the rib He had taken out of the man, and He brought her to the man. Now, He formed the man, but He made the woman. That word literally means to build. And so once again, we have this picture that God was intimately involved in the creation of that first woman. Of course, we know what happens to this image of God in which Adam and Eve were created. In Genesis 3, sin comes into the world and everything gets messed up. Nevertheless, because of this original position of being created in God's image, human life is given special value in Scripture. For example, in Genesis 9:6, we read, "Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed." And then the reason for that is given. "For in the image of God has God made man." So even after mankind's fall into sin, because they were originally created in God's image, human life is afforded special value and dignity. Now we know what God said to those first two human beings. He told Adam and Eve to be fruitful and to multiply. And we know what that meant. God sets into motion now a biological process for procreation. But God is still involved in that process. Psalm 139 reminds us of that. "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made." We get a different verb. Adam was formed, Eve was built, and every human being, God says, is knit together. Now, we know that God doesn't have these tiny little knitting needles inside a woman's uterus. But once again, the picture is that God is still intimately involved, hands-on, if you would, with the creation of each and every human being. I like to tell folks that we all have a little tag on the back of our neck that reads, handmade by God. Human life, then, has value, first of all, because it's the work of God's hands in creation. Our second foundation stone is that every human life has value because it's a life redeemed by Jesus. Redeemed means to buy something back. It means to buy something back with a price. And that's exactly what Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 6. You were bought with a price. And of course, we know that price wasn't gold or silver, but it was the holy, precious blood and innocent suffering and death of God's Son, Jesus Christ. Now think about that. Those hands that knit you together in your mother's womb, those hands stretched out on a cross, and they were pierced, and they bled, and that blood cleanses us from all sin. Every human life has value because every human life is a life for whom Jesus died. Those are our two foundation stones upon which we want to stand as we look at stem cell research and cloning. Human life has value because it's the work of God's hands in creation. And human life has value because it's the work of God's hands in redemption. Now that we've laid those foundation stones of our theology, let's look at a little biology. Human life begins at the moment of conception. Once the genetic material of the sperm combines with the genetic material in the egg, a new and unique human life has begun. Here's what you look like as a one-celled human being, a zygote, right there in the center of that picture. At this moment, you were a unique human being. In fact, you are the result of a possible 1 in 70 trillion chromosomal combinations. And growth continues. And here's what you look like at that first cell division. Now, what's interesting is that each of these cells that you see here can become a complete human being. And sometimes these cells split apart at this point, and they result in twins. This is how identical twins are formed. And here's what you look like at the 4-cell stage, and here you are at the 8-cell stage. And here you are after about 5 days from conception, and you're now referred to as a blastocyst. You were basically a hollow ball with a single cell layer forming the outside of this ball. And on the inside, there was this cluster of cells called the inner cell mass. Now, that's important for us to remember when we get into stem cell research. Now, at this point, you're still in your mother's fallopian tube, making your way to the uterus. And when you get there, you are going to snuggle into the uterus and begin to grow. And here's what you'll look like after 8 weeks from conception. Now, I realize that was a big jump from 5 days to 8 weeks. But I did that on purpose because I want to help you understand something by comparing these two slides.